As for me personally, I'm a graphic designer by trade, turned out a man, so I'm more advertising these days, and I've spent 30 consecutive years working in the creative industries in this region. I'm a non-conventionally educated, born and bred Brummie, as you can probably tell, who's learning on the job. I started off as a tea boy with hair and stuff like that. I've worked through three recessions. I've worked with global brands, I've worked with one-man bands, I've worked with serious players and absolute time wasters and everything in between. It's been a journey. And I've come to the conclusion that creative, entrepreneur, it's kind of the same thing. It's kind of in the blood, it's in the genes. For 12 of those 30 years that I've been working in the creative industries, I co-owned and ran my own agency. I don't do that anymore. I've got a job again, so, and that's weird. But anyway, but I do have a thing or two to share about business ownership. So with that in mind, I want to talk to you first about why I think so many creative people end up running their own businesses or working for themselves to provide their own income. Then I'll tell you a little bit of my story, and particularly on those 12 years, focusing there, spent running an agency, growing from nothing to a fairly successful business. And then I'll finish off with a few tips and tricks that I think you'll find useful. Either right now, if you're thinking of leaving this place and going straight into business ownership, or to keep in your locker as and when that opportunity arises. Sound good? Creativity is just so much more democratic these days due to digital. I started off back in 1987 in this game, and it was all very draftsman-like back then. Drawing boards, pens, pencils, remember those, and set squares, drawing boards, smoking indoors, weapons grade swearing, that kind of thing. Yeah, you get the picture? And to create something just as insignificant as a leaflet was a major, major undertaking that would involve a group of people and a lot of time. And to start off with, the guy or girl that designed this leaflet, this fictional leaflet, and the person who created the artwork for it were two separate people. And they usually hated each other. Someone else would do the typesetting, someone else would take photographs, another would do retouching, and my God, that was expensive. You'd need an illustrator if you wanted a specific style. And if you went to use stock photography, well, let's just say that was a right pain in the ass. Okay, and we'll leave it there. But soon enough, along came Steve Jobs with his cute little computer. And everything changed in the space of, well, it seemed like 5 minutes at the time thinking that. So over the next few years, the Apple Macintosh, to give it its full name, and as it used to be known, rolled up all of these tasks, plus a whole load more, and handed them straight to the designer and said, knock yourself out. So the designer now has complete and total control over their output. And the designer now is also an animator, filmmaker, 3D modeler, co-writer, a whole world of other creative outlets were now possible by a person that used to exist at a drawing board with a pencil and a cigarette. And with the internet rolling for good measure as the years went by, you have the ultimate reference library, endless content provision, and as many broadcast channels as you could possibly wish for, that only grow day after day after day after day. All at your fingertips. So all you've got to do these days is buy a laptop, get a broadband connection, obviously you need a brain as well, right? A debit card, and you're in business. So with this much freedom and power in a single device that you can slip into your bag, why be tied to a desk? Yeah? Why be tied to a business? Why be tied to a boss? Yeah? We can do it ourselves. So that's the first reason, I think, why so many people in your shoes are going off and doing it themselves, because quite simply you can. But the accomplished creative can also sell. And I'm a firm believer that with the power at our fingertips that we have as creatives these days, it's vitally important to be able to sell your work. Not be a shrinking buyer, be able to walk into a room and say, this is what I do, isn't it brilliant, give me lots of money for it. Do that confidently. A can managers, or anyone else for that matter, won't give the same passion that you do for the work that you've created. That can only come from you, the originator. Some people get a bit of stage fright when they're standing in front of clients. It's only natural, you know, particularly if you're not that way inclined, generally. But it's not difficult to sell your own work if you have done the work and yourself justice. Confident presentation requires three key elements: belief, preparation, and confidence. So first of all, belief. Belief in the work that you've created, yeah? You've emptied your head, you've got to the good stuff. Because even if you're not creative, the crap ideas are at the beginning, you've got to get through them. It's when you think, oh yeah, I can't have any more ideas, and then suddenly you do. And that's the goal, yeah, you've got to find that. And then you've got to prepare to present, you've got to know your lines, you've got to refine your pitch, you've got to go in there confidently, and that preparation breeds the confidence you need to present passionately and convincingly. So, good creators can sell as well. That's another person you're going to need, right? And three, as I said earlier, it's in the blood. Entrepreneurial spirit is in the creative person at a root level. But most creatives will start in the industry taking a job, in the main. Maybe not so much these days, but in the main, we'll take a job in an agency or in a studio. But just take a look at some of the most successful agencies from around the world. Abbott Meadows, Bartle Bogle Hegarted and BBH, Siegel and Gale, Fallon, Wolf Ollins, Shire Day, Doyle Dane Birnbach, Trados, Bonange, Wiesendanger, Ashrol, or TBW, to give them a more convenient moniker. It's just a list of names, right? Just a list of people. All of these global agency brands that have created the most creative work the world has ever seen all started out as individuals working at another agency or another studio, just thinking, I hated it. I hate my boss. And they decided one day, I'm just going to do it myself. And boy, could they do it themselves, yeah? And you guys see, four of you have bundled together and become the next global brand doing that as well. That entrepreneurial gene is in every creative, I believe. And at some point in any creative's career, a door is going to open. An opportunity to go it alone, or jump in with a group of like-minded individuals to start something of your own, something brand new. Sometimes that door will be blatantly obvious. Sometimes it won't. But it will open, trust me. And when it does, you need to be ready to jump through it or even kick it down if you need to. Okay? Which brings me on to my own experience as a person that owned and ran my own business, as I said, for about 12 years. So at some point in your career, a door will open for the opportunity for you guys to work for yourself. That door opened for me in late 2003. I'd been working at a very successful Birmingham-based agency for about 10 years. I loved that place. From 1993 to 2003, straddling the Britpop era, had really nice hair, I was single, it was a fantastic time. I never thought it would ever end, but obviously this thing we call the creative industry rips itself apart every 5 years anyway, so it did end. I'd forged some great friendships, won a great many national and international awards, nursed an enormous amount of hangovers, and generally had a blast. Then the recession before last bit really hard. The recessions do this to create companies, okay? This particular agency relied on an automotive importer as its bread and butter business. But it's quite clever this. The company, the client never actually paid the agency anything. The agency got paid by media kickback. And kickback means, forgive me if I'm saying this subject here, but kickback means that if you buy a considerable amount of any commodity, you get cash back as a benefit, as the vendor. So when your biggest client is spending £10 million on media in a 12-month period, and you're on a 10% kickback deal, that's a nice little earn, right? And it also means the client is getting free work, win-win. But it also means that if that same client stops all media expenditure because of severe trading conditions, you're up shit creek, okay? A few more modest clients moved on, and suddenly this agency was in real trouble. Real trouble. I mean, redundancy is at a really high level. I mean, you could tell that the alarm bells were ringing really, really hard. So, as a result, that agency was sold to a Leamington Spa-based agency, Rival, at a real fire sale price. Now, we all thought at the top end of it we were going to be part of an MBO, a management buyout, which never happened, obviously, because the guys that owned the company were keen to get out as quick as possible. So both of these new agencies were combined in the Birmingham office. Now, this meant a load of the Leamington-based people who were on the wrong side of the Cotswolds from a commuting perspective left as the commute jungle. Then, the acquiring agency realised they couldn't get out their property lease in Leamington Spa. But the owners of Birmingham actually owned their buildings, so they could sell it on. So everyone was then bussed back to Leamington Spa to run. Again, a load of other people, due to the same commuting issues, but on the other side of the country, also. So, before the dust had settled on this merger, the new agency was now the same size as each of its component parts before they were brought together. What a thing that was, okay? A lesson in how not to merge companies. So, over the next 12 months, the new agency lost a client every month, with it to the point where the Birmingham element only had one client left of any relevance. Other than the automotive client that I mentioned, which was now vastly downsized. So both myself and two other friends of this agency had a really good relationship with the marketing director at this particular client, which was a Midlands-based retail business. And at a meeting one day, she said to us, "I don't like this agency at all. It's not going well. I think I'm going to move the business." No! It was literally the last bastion of creativity from an account perspective that we had in the agency. "I think I'm going to put it with X agency. Unless someone gives me an alternative." And there's the saying, "That door opening." So forgive me telling that elaborate story, but you know, it's just understanding that, you know, these doors are going to open sometimes by really, really strange, unexpected circumstances. So, needless to say, without much thought, we keep that door down. Our notices were handed in, and we set up our first business. So, we needed a name. The company was owned and run by creatives. I was a graphic designer. My business partners were a creative team. We had no account executives or suits, as they're known. So we became Unsuitable, which was a nice unusual name, and so it seemed to rub certain people up the wrong way. But we were off and running. We started off, and there was three of us in my back bedroom, and within 3 years we'd gone up to about 10 people, about £500,000 worth of turnover, which was great. But the shift to digital rapidly took up 70% of our business, so we needed to change. And that's probably accurate for the agencies these days. So in 2007, we set up a sister digital agency. After much debate, we decided to call that agency One Black Bear. Why? A story I won't bore you with, because we've got other things to talk about. But at the time, it made sense to annex digital clients because there was skepticism out there as to whether normal agencies could deliver digital work. In a good way. We also managed to get some autonomous digital clients that were specialists sitting on their roster of meat and pigeonhole companies, including that automotive importer I mentioned from a few years back, which was a nice thing. But you know, this business is always changing. The advent of social media made us think a few years later. In 2012, another agency came online called Shadow Giants, which leveraged social as a powerful and new challenge. About this time, being a digital standalone, it ceased to be relevant, really. So One Black Bear became the front door for the advertising and the digital business, and the Unsuitable name faded away. Now, I left that business a couple of years ago, which I'll come on to, and since then, Shadow Giants has also been rolled into that one business, so One Black Bear is now the front door across the whole creative spectrum. It is a spectrum now, creativity. You know, as an agency, we're expected to deliver so much. So, after 12 years of being a creative entrepreneur and running my own thing, why pack it all in? Why get a job in it? Which brings me nicely on to the last point. And that's based on my own experience and what I think creative entrepreneurship is, just a few tips if you're thinking about taking the plunge straight from studying here. Firstly, running a creative business, you really do need to be ready for anything. I mean, I hope you'd all realise that events since the last downturn have informed most people of that. I mean, it's difficult to know what normal is these days, right? Well, Ronald Reagan was a comic book. Jesus. But, you know, that makes running any business a really uncertain thing, okay? But you've got to add to that truth that the creative industries are forever shifting. There's always something new. We're always prospecting and looking for the next big thing. The creative industries turn themselves inside out every few years or so. They have done for the 30 years I've been in business. New channels come online and older ones expire and fade away. I mean, when the advent of Twitter, who would have thought that that's turned into the business model it is now? The amount of money you can make for social and how much corporate clients really want that type of expertise. But also, you've got to understand that for every few good years, there's going to be a few bad ones thrown in that you'll need to endure, okay? You need to save some money. Don't buy the Bentley straight away. I mean, back to my experience, that the credit crunch and the subsequent economic downturn hit like a vice in 2008. I will never, ever forget it. And the only thing that saved us is the fact that we looked at digital and said, we need to be in that space. We can't insist on doing press ads and posters and brochures. That really saved our lives. But the speed at which that recession hit absolutely transformed our business. It was a massive shock to the system. So, you know, be prepared. We lost our founding and biggest client almost immediately, as Lehman Brothers shut its doors. And then every other company we worked with cut their spend by at least half. And this happened in about 6 weeks. So 1.5 paydays. I don't know how often you get paid. Needless to say, extremely stressful times. I wouldn't dare to repeat, which changed my outlook forever. It's not very nice having to pay your salary on a credit card. So, creative entrepreneurs need to be ready to evolve. And are more accepting of change than most, I say. You know, we all understand that a job for life doesn't really exist, but I think we're more accepting of that in what we do here. But you know, those shifting sands of the creative industries can be extremely lucrative for people who spot the trends. Spot that they're on the horizon and exploit them first. We're going to do that. It's a fact that recession often impacts the creative industries first. What we do can be the easiest thing to put a red line through on the balance sheet for a financial act. Okay? As companies hibernate in the hope that they're going to wake in more profitable times, let's just stop marketing. We don't need marketing. We don't need to do another website. We can hang on to this one. But as the green shoots of recovery begin to appear, we can often do the sector that recovers quickest. As those same slumbering companies reawake again and think, Jesus, yeah, things are better now, we need to start selling some stuff, so you know, let's give a load of money to an agency. So, I mean, this isn't a cautionary tale, but I think it's really important to stress that you really need to have your eyes open when you go out into the world to start a business. Secondly, as a business owner, you're going to get pulled in lots and lots of directions. You'll be writing strategy documents 1 minute, designing something the next, then you've got to do the bins, then you've got a meeting, then you've got to buy some milk because there's no milk for the tea for the meeting. You know, you've got lots of place to keep in here. So you've got to remember why you started your business in the first place and keep that as a centre, as a mantra that keeps you on track. You've got to have that. It's got to be vital. And it can't be money. Can't be money. The chase for growth and profit will take you out of your comfort zone and you'll have to start doing other stuff. It certainly did me. I ended up doing all sorts of stuff I had no business doing in my own business. As my business struggled and I tried to save it by trying to do sales and, you know, anyway. I'm no longer part of it. And that's one of the reasons. I have a job again. As creative director at Superdream, I'm back on the payroll, but I'm back doing what I do best, I found my centre. I do ideas. because ideas always endure. Regardless of tech advances, regardless of trends, thinkers will always have a role in our business. Unless the boffin is really going to figure out how to do artificial intelligence. Thanks for listening, and best of luck to you and all your career.